بسم
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. We can begin from سورة الرحمن. Like the brother hinted, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in that surah, خلق الإنسان من صلصال كالفخار وخلق الجان من مارج من نار. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam, our father. You know, all of us, in spite of our different colors, in spite of our different languages, we were created from one man called Adam alayhi salam. And amazing, Adam, by the way, some of you may not know this, didn't go through what we go through. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fashioned Adam and he breathed subhanah, the soul, into Adam. So Adam was not a baby. Adam was not breastfed. Adam did not have some child time. So Adam found himself what? A man. Like that. Now, let me ask you this question, which is very simple. That is why there will be no prizes. But again, no collective answers. Did Adam have a father?
No.
I said no collective answers. You guys don't understand English? I don't speak Somali. Do I need to speak Somali here? Do you guys understand English? You know what there is no collective answer means? That raise your hand, I will pick you. Did Adam have a father? Yes, brother. No, he did not. Next question. Did Adam have a mother? Yes, brother. No. So Adam did not have a father, nor what? A mother. After Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam, he placed him into a garden, Jannah. Then Adam felt lonely. I'm alone. No one around me. You know that feeling of feeling alone? Then he made dua, oh Allah, can I have a companion? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created from Adam his wife. What is her name? Yes, brother. Hawa in Arabic. In English, what is her name? In English, what is her name? Eve. Speak up, young man. Eve. So he had his wife. Now I'm going to ask you the question. Did Hawa have a mother? Did Hawa / Eve had a mother? Yes. 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 Yes or no? No, she did not. Next question. Did Hawa have a father? Yes.
No.
What do you mean no? She was created from who? So Adam is the father. You getting that? So Hawa had a father. So now we're having someone who had no father, no mother, and another creation who had a father, no mother. What about you and me? I'm going to ask, what about you and me? Do we have fathers and mothers? Do we have fathers and mothers? Yes. So now, look at this now. Adam did not have a father nor a mother. Hawa had a father, no mother. Me and you have a father and a mother. What is missing now? What is missing for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to show us that he can create anything that he wants? Anything that he wants. What is missing here? Okay, what is missing? Who? Tennis? Okay, I didn't hear you. Can somebody convey his message to me? Okay, what is missing here? So we got somebody who was created without a father, without a mother. Someone who was created with a father, without a mother. And we are created with a father and a mother. Who is missing now? What is missing? Yes. I'm not asking who, but what is the formula? Someone to be born without what? You gotta tell me that. Someone to be born into this world with a mother, without a father. Imagine this. With a mother, without a father. So now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shown us that He can create human beings without fathers, without mothers, Adam. With a father, without a mother, Eve, Hawa. With a mother, without a father, Isa alayhi salatu wassalam. And you and me with a father and a mother. So Allah is able to do what? Anything, correct? Allah is able to do anything. Now, Christians believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took Isa alayhi salam as a son. And this is what Christmas is all about. You know, all these lights that you see in the streets, all these trees, all these jingle bell that you hear wherever you go, all these things about that celebration, they are celebrating the fact, according to them, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had a son called Isa alayhi salatu wassalam. Now, why did they say that? Let's be smart here. Let's understand why they are saying that. Why they are saying that? Because it is true that Prophet Isa alayhi salam was born without a father. He did not have a father. So they said, obviously the father has to be who? But do we believe that? And this is how the Quran, by the way, responded to this argument. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells them, listen, إِنَّ مَثَلَ عِيسَى عِنْدَ اللَّهِ كَمَثَلِ آدَمْ. The likeness of Isa is like Adam. You guys are saying Isa is the son of Allah because he did not have a father. If there is someone out there who qualifies to be the son, would be who? Answer me. Collectively, answer me, would be who? Adam. Why? Because Adam did not have what? At least Isa had a mother. That is why his name is Isa ibn Maryam. Isa, the son of Maryam. Maryam is his mother. Now you're saying that Prophet Isa alayhi salam is the son of Allah because of this? I'm sorry. What about Adam? He did not have a father nor a mother. He is more qualified to be called that, which we do not believe. Now, Christians also believe that this happened on the 25th or the 26th, I think 25th. Is it the 25th of December? We don't even know that. But in any rate, we as Muslims cannot believe that Allah has children. Why? Why it is an insult to say this about Allah? And by the way, from now on, any time that I use that term, Allah has a son, I want to hear from you, Subhanallah. And I'll explain to you what does it mean, Subhanallah. So any time that you hear me saying, Allah begets a son, Allah begets a son, no, say it in a defensive way, in a Subhanallah, I like that. Allah begets a son, Subhanallah. Allah begets a son, Subhanallah. Allah begets a son, and I want you to look at the Quran. Every time this is mentioned, always Subhana, Subhanak, Subhanallah is mentioned. وَقَالُوا اتَّخَذَ الرَّحْمَنُ وَلَدًا سُبْحَانَ سُبْحَانَ سُبْحَانَك وَإِذْ قَالَ اللَّهُ يَا عِيسَى ابْنَ مَرْيَمَ أَأَنْتَ قُلْتَ لِلنَّاسِ اتَّخِذُونِي وَأُمِّيَ إِلَهَيْنِ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ قَالَ سُبْحَانَك. Always, always. ما كان لله أن يتخذ من ولد سبحانه. Always. What subhanallah means? When you say subhanallah, what does it mean? It means you're making tanzih. What does it mean? The people out there buying the Christmas trees, putting all these lights, and they are celebrating, getting gifts, all these things, to celebrate the birthday of the Son of Allah. Subhanallah. And you're saying what? Man, don't, as if you're telling me, man, don't say that. Allah is above that. Allah is above that. You know that statement Allah said about it in the Quran? Allah said about it in the Hadith, it's an insult. You want to hear what Allah said about that statement? It's really overwhelming. Allah says fil hadith, shataman ibn Adam. The son of Adam insults me. You know what shat means? To insult somebody. The son of Adam insults me. وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لَهُ ذَلِكَ. And the son of Adam should not do that. I created him. I given him the life that he has. I given him the wealth, the health, the children, the money. And he still insults me. Then Allah says, how does he insult me when he says that I beget a son? Subhanallah, when I have a son. Why it is an insult? But before I go there, just to show you the reaction of some of the creation of Allah upon hearing the statement that Allah has a son. Are you awake? Say it like you mean it, man. I'm going to share with you from the Quran the reaction of some of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon hearing the human being saying that Allah begets a son. You see, we as humans should say what? Subhanallah. We should say that. Subhanallah. But look, hear this. In a chapter called Maryam. Who is Maryam? The mother of who? Of Isa. That chapter. Look at this. وقالوا اتخذ الرحمن ولدا. Say Subhanallah. They say Ar-Rahman begets a son. لقد جئتم شيئا إدا. No more. We're done. Look at the creation now. Look. تكاد السماوات يتفطرن منه. You see, we as human, we should say Subhanallah. But look at the heavens are about to crack open and fall in us. تكاد السماوات تنشق منه. تكاد السماوات ها يتفطرن منه وتنشق الأرض. The earth is about to swallow us. The earth is angry, is upset. The heaven is angry, is upset. وتخر الجبال هدا. And the mountains are about to crumble on us. Why? أن دعوا للرحمن ولدا. Because they say الرحمن, الله الرحمن begets a son. See, we can say Subhanallah. We can condemn that. Now Subhanallah, ikhwa, يعني just to show you where the Muslims are. Wallahi, I was told today that there are some Muslims who have Christmas trees in their houses. Just to show you the ignorance of Muslims now. There are Muslims who go and tell non-Muslims Merry Christmas. As if they are telling him, yeah, it's okay to call Allah that he has a son. Huh? Some Muslims go to the Christmas party and they eat. Some young children, young Muslims, guess what? They look at their non-Muslim friends. Oh man, you have a Christmas tree. Lucky you, man. You have all these gifts under the Christmas tree, man. And you're going to get a lot of gifts. Huh? Should I do that as a Muslim?
No.
Should I do that as a Muslim?
No.
Or should I stand for what I believe in? Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked that question in Surah Maryam. وَمَا يَنْبَغِي لِلرَّحْمَنِ أَنْ يَتَّخِذَ وَلَدًا. Why Ar-Rahman, why Allah needs to take a son? Now I want you to think, because look at this now. You see, we have to give da'wah to those people. You know, a lot of their children, they didn't get a chance to learn that stuff that you guys are learning. They were brought up in that environment all their lives. And they are waiting for you to share that knowledge with them. Hopefully they will wake up one day and they will rectify these beliefs. But here is what we should share with them. Imagine me, a human being. Why do I need to have a son as a human being? I need some people to volunteer to answer. Why someone like me need to have children? Why? What do I need children for? All right. Okay, Harun. They make dua for you after you die. What else? Yes. To help you. When you grow old, you want them to take care of when you get old. What else? You pass on what? To pass on money to your own children, or Islam to your own children, inheritance. Yani, all together is a package. And Islam too. Yeah, I know, but everything. Meaning you will die, yani. Now the question that I want to ask you, does Allah need someone to help him?
No.
Say Subhanallah, man. What? No. Say no, Subhanallah. Say no, Subhanallah.
No, Subhanallah.
You see, I get old I get old, I can't work anymore, I can't do it. Does Allah get old? Say no, subhanallah. Allah takes care of everything. Does Allah die? Say subhanallah. No, subhanallah. Allah doesn't die. So that people would inherit him. Allah doesn't need that. And that is why when you say Allah has a son, you're making Allah like us, like the human. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created everything. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't need to have children. We need to have children. It is imperfection for a human not to have kids. But it is imperfection for Allah to have children. It is. And ta'ala Allahu anil naqs. Allah is above all imperfection. Allah is perfect. Allah doesn't need anybody to help him. Allah doesn't need anyone to inherit him, because Allah doesn't die. And this is why we do not believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a son. And this is why we cannot participate in these celebrations. We can't. We can't even go out there and tell the people Merry Christmas. We can't. We cannot do that. As Muslims, we cannot do that. Because when you're telling them these things, as if you're approving what they believe. But does this mean that we have to be disrespectful and mean to them? We can do this what? In a kind, respectful way. We still need to show respect for them. And I want to share with you the story of the first immigrants in Islam. And you probably know about it. When some of the Muslims who used to live in Mecca were unable to take the persecution, the punishment, the bad treatment at the hands of the people in Mecca, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam directed them to make hijrah, to migrate to a place called Abyssinia. You know where Abyssinia is, right? You don't know where Abyssinia is? Huh? Ethiopia? Habasha? Which name you guys like? Ethiopia, right? Habasha, right? The people there used to be Christians. And they used to believe, that Jesus is the Son. Subhanallah. Allah is above that. But yet, the leader of that nation decided to accept the Muslims living there as Muslims. Now the people of Quraysh knew what the Muslims believe about Jesus. They said, these guys ran away from us and they went to a Christian land. And you know, the Christians believe that Jesus is the Son of Allah. But the Muslims do not believe that. They say subhanallah to them. So now we have a chance to make the Abyssinians, to make the people, the Christians, hate the Muslims, so that they will kick them out and will bring them back to Mecca to punish them and make them leave their Islam. And not only that, they decided to take a lot of briberies. You know what a bribery is? Like stuff that the people like. They like the skin of the camels and animals, because they like that, to bribe them. And they sent a friend of the Nagas, a friend of the leader of that nation, Amr ibn al-As, who was not a Muslim yet, radiallahu anhu. Him and al-Najashi, the Nagas, used to be very close friends to one another. So when he arrived, he said to him, listen, some people run away from Mecca. They are called Muslims. They are called Muslims. And they came to your land. But they don't believe that Jesus is the Son of Allah. They are insulting you. Can you bring them back with me so I take them back to Mecca? Can I take them back to Mecca? And, you know, because it's not right for them to insult you like this. The man was feared, like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned about him. The Prophet actually said to his companions that this man is feared. He's not going to wrong you. Subhanallah. He refused to give the Muslims up to his buddy, to his friend. Meanwhile, he paid a lot of briberies. And he presented the case to them. He said, I will not give them back to you without listening to their side of the story. So now the Muslims, small group of Muslims living in a Christian land, and they knew that they are going to be asked tomorrow about Isa. Who is Isa? Is it the Son of Allah? For you to stay here? Or is not? And you're going to be taken out. See that? See that situation right here? Imagine. Alhamdulillah, we're not asked. Nobody's going to drag us back to our countries. Nobody's going to punish us for not saying Merry Christmas. Nobody is going to punish us for not having Christmas tree. Nobody's going to punish us for, you know, you can live. Nobody. But look at those early Muslims. They were under pressure. They were faced with a pressuring situation. So they had a meeting the night before answering the question about Jesus tomorrow, alayhi salatu wasalam. So they looked at one another and they said, what will we say tomorrow? If we don't say the things that leader want to hear, he's going to shackle us, chain us, and send us back to Mecca, where the people are going to punish us, going to give us a hard time. They may kill us. What should we say? Should we compromise? Should we tell them that Ja'far, the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Ibn Abi Talib, radiyallahu anhu, said, by Allah, we will only say what Allah said about Isa in the Quran. We care less. It's the truth. We're going to tell the people the truth. Allah chosen us to help the people to believe in Allah. Not to help them to disbelieve in Allah and say Allah has a son and insult Allah and gain the wrath of Allah, the anger of Allah. If we care about those people, because those people helped us, they saved us from them. Now if we do not tell them the truth, we're lying to them. We're cheating them. When you go and tell a Christian Merry Christmas, you're cheating that Christian. If you care about that Christian, you should tell him the truth. You should tell him who Allah is. If you really care. But if you go and compromise and you be one of them, you're not going to help them out. You're deceiving them for your own benefit, because you want them to accept you, to give you more privileges, to give you more fame, more money, whatever you want. But if you truly care about the people here, you should tell them who Jesus is in a respectful, kind way. The morning they arrived, the leader, the Nagas in Najashi, asked them, what do you say about Jesus right now? What do you say about Jesus? Imagine this. Ja'far said, radiallahu anhu, we only say about Jesus what Allah said. Jesus is the messenger of Allah, the slave of Allah. His word was given to Maryam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel to breathe the soul into him. And he asked the king, can I recite to you, please, chapter Maryam? And this is something, Ikhwa, that you should share with Christians. You see, they always tell that story. In that chapter, Allah said it. You know what story I'm talking about? They call it the story of nativity, which is the story of birth of Jesus. Subhanallah, Allah mentioned that story in a very beautiful way in the Quran, and I'm going to share it with you, and I'm going to finish. And that's what Ja'far radiallahu anhu recited to the Nagas. The story quickly begins with, وَذْكُرْ فِي الْكِتَابِ مَرْيَمَ إِذِ انْتَبَذَتْ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا مَكَانًا شَرْقِيًّا. Maryam was an orphan. Her father passed away. His name is Imran. He passed away. She became an orphan. Now the one who took care of her was a prophet called Zakaria. And Zakaria used to work inside the Masjid Al-Aqsa. Inside the Masjid Al-Aqsa in Jerusalem. He used to be the main imam there, the leader. So he's taking care of Maryam, so Maryam has to stay in the Masjid. Subhanallah, Maryam was so devout. She used to pray a lot. She decided to take a room in one of the Masjid, and she just prays all the time. فَانْتَبَذَتْ مِنْ دُونِهِمْ حِجَابًا. She actually took a hijab, take a wall like this. And she just keeps praying. And Allah would bless her with things out of this world. Like Zakaria sometimes would come, and he will find her having watermelon in the winter. You know, I know now we can have watermelon in the winter, but at this time, to have watermelon in the winter, and he would ask her, Zakaria, who brought that food to you? هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ كُلَّمَا دَخَلَ عَلَيْهَا زَكَرِيَّ الْمِحْرَابَ وَجَدَ عِنْدَهَا رِزْقًا قَالَ يَا مَرْيَمُ أَنَّا لَكِ هَذَا قَالَتْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَرْزُقُ مَنْ يَشَاءُ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. When Maryam grown up and she became a woman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to her Jibreel in a form of a human being. Imagine she was praying and by all the sudden this good looking man. Imagine an angel looking like a human, very good looking man, enters in her room. She got scared of him and she said, قَالَتْ إِنِّي أَعُوذُ بِالرَّحْمَنِ مِنْكَ إِن كُنْتَ تَقِيًّا. I seek refuge with Allah, stay away from me. Don't come near me. Then Jibreel عليه السلام, Jibreel عليه السلام said to her, قال إنما أنا رسول ربك لأهب لك غلاما زكيا. I was sent to you by Allah to make you have a baby. She immediately looked at him. قالت أنا يكون لي غلام ولم يمسسني بشر ولم أك بغيا. How I'm going to have a baby when no man touched me? And I'm not a bad woman. I'm not a wicked woman. I pray all the time. I wear my hijab. I don't have any relationship with boys before marriage. I'm a Muslimah. I don't do that. قال كذلك قال ربك. It's going to be done. Jibreel alayhi salam blown in here. And that blow made her pregnant. That's all we know. She became pregnant. Now imagine a young girl like this living in a society. You can't have kids out of wedlock. You can't. No, right now, these wicked times, a girl can come to her daddy, daddy, I'm pregnant, and she's not even married. Haram, adultery. That's haram. It's been always haram. Adultery has been always haram. So she started to say, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? Now I'm pregnant and I'm not married. What the people are going to say about me? I committed adultery. That's the only way you're going to think they're going to think of me. That's the only way they will think of me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to her, listen, you don't have to do anything. When you deliver, take the baby and go to your family, go to the people. When they ask you, who is this? Don't speak. Just let him do the speech. Let him speak on your behalf. Look at this. فَأَتَتْ بِهِ قَوْمَهَا تَحْمِلُهُ. So she carried the baby after she delivered and she came to the people. Imagine as soon as they saw her, قَالُوا يَا مَرْيَمُ لَقَدْ جِئْتِ شَيْئًا فَرِيًّا. What is this? What is this, Ya Maryam? You, Ya Maryam, we see you praying all the time, wearing your hijab. You having a baby without a father, out of wedlock. What is this? Ya أخت هارون ما كان أبوك امرأ سوء. You come from the line of Aaron, Harun Akhu Musa, the brother of Musa. If you trace Maryam back, she goes to Harun. All of your family are righteous people. And your father Imran used to be the Imam of Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. Your father Imran used to be the Imam. He died. What's wrong with you? Look. فَأَشَارَتْ إِلَيْهِ. She pointed at Jesus, the baby, the cradle. You know, a little baby, infant. They looked at her and they said, قَالُوا كَيْفَ نُكَلِّمُ مَنْ كَانَ فِي الْمَهْدِ صَبِيًّا. How are we going to talk to a baby in the cradle? They don't speak. Imagine, look, the first words that came out of the mouth of Jesus, peace be upon him. What did he say? قَالَ إِنِّي عَبْدُ اللَّهِ. The baby spoke. He said, what? قَالَ إِنِّي عَبْدُ اللَّهِ. Subhanallah. The first words that came out of the mouth of Jesus, peace be upon him. آتَانِيَ الْكِتَابِ. He given me the Injil. وَجَعَلَنِي نَبِيًّا. And he made me a prophet. وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ. And he made me blessed wherever I am. Meaning I enjoin good and forbid evil. That's the best interpretation of this. When I see something wrong, I speak of it.
وَأَوْصَانِي بِالصَّلَاةِ وَالزَّكَاةِ مَا دُمْتُ حَيَّا.
And Allah commanded me to pray and to pay zakah as long as I live. Not only this,
وَبَرًّا بِوَالِدَتِي.
And I'm kind to my mother. Imagine this, when Ja'far recited these verses to the Nagas, he looked at him, to Najashi, to the leader. Imagine, that's why telling people the truth is good. You see, when you go and tell them Merry Christmas, you're cheating them, you're deceiving them. When you go and participate in their parties, you're condoning their haram. You're not helping them. You think that makes you a tolerant, kind person? No, you're a cheater. You're a deceiver. You're not telling them the truth. You're not telling them what they should believe. You see, the Nagas, the Najashi, became a Muslim. Tears came out of his mouth, out of his eyes, and he said, "By Allah, this is who Jesus is. This is who Jesus." And he became a Muslim. And he looked at his friend Amr, he said, Amr, even if you bribe me with the world, if you give me the world, I will not give up these Muslims because they are believers, they have the truth. This is what Christmas for us. And this is the talk that we should have about Christmas. جزاكم الله خيرا سبحانك اللهم بحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والحمد لله رب العالمين. I rest my case. Alright. جزاكم الله خيرا.
ومن أحسن قولا ممن دعا إلى الله وعمل صالحا.